That's my, it's my personal opinion.
That's all right.
I think that we should have a full-time mayor with, maybe, I don't even think we need an administrator position. I think that the mayor should be full-time, and he should have direct contact with all the directors, and that's how the borough should be run.
Colleen?
I have questions. Over the second term, I would say, of present mayor, I've seen, and unfortunately even televised, very clear polarization, mayor versus council, council versus mayor. And this question's to all candidates. How can you possibly change that in changing the whole charter?
Well, I guess one way of change is what I had said before, is that if you have a management council type of government, then your council is making your decisions. You don't have somebody that you have to buck heads with if he's not of the same party. If you're down to, let's say we have seven council people, you know, maybe they are five of one political party. But now five are making that decision. It's not just one person making that decision. But once you have a strong mayor type of council, a strong mayor type of home rule charter, and you have a council that's just the legislation part of it, is when you run into your problems. That's, you know, my feeling. I'm sure the other candidates have other. I'm sure Bill has a saying on it, because Bill was in the original forming of the charter. And, you know, it went in the strong mayor type of home rule charter at that time. Whether Bill's happy with it, Mr. DeAngelis is happy with it now or not, I can't answer that. But I see he's here as a candidate to reform it.
I just have to say that as a resident, I've been a resident of Norristown since 1990, and as a voter, it's very, very demoralizing when you want, you know, your local government to function, and what you see is a constant battle back and forth between the mayor and the council, and, you know, more and more the council view that they're weak, all right. And why? Because the mayor, is it because he has more powers, or is it because, all right, the, you know, home rule charter, that it's a, whether it be interpretation, whether, you know, it be because they're not knowledgeable about the do's and do nots, in and outs of the charter. I mean, I have some very, you know, serious concerns about this, and how, you know, changing the charter is going to give more power, all right, to all parties involved. That the government runs versus let's spend some time with the lawsuits, let's, you know, spend time, all right, with the, you know, bashing on television and the newspaper. I just really think it's been a very dysfunctional government the last 4 years.
Well, I as always, I have an opinion. And the opinion is, in this case, that if you elect council people, if you have a legislative branch and you have the mayor, they may be elected as independents, Republicans, or Democrats. But once they're in position, they analyze the questions, they analyze the problems they have, and they vote in regard to their own personal opinion as to what's best for the community. Now, that's the idealistic situation. As a practical matter, obviously they're voted on by the party. There has to be something, there has to be some connection or some semblance of order and responsibility. But if it comes to an issue like interpretation, and you throw the interpretation up to the solicitor, he has to do it without any special connection with the mayor or the council. He has to do it based upon, as if he were sitting in Washington someplace giving his opinion, without favoring the mayor or without favoring council. He has to give a totally unpolitical decision. So I think there are lots of these problems rest upon the quality of the solicitor you're going to have and the quality of the people who are elected to office. They have to be, forget about being a Democrat, forget about being a Republican, forget about being able to be fired by the mayor if they give the wrong answer. So there has to be a lot of courage from everybody, and the public has to encourage them to have that courage. And they can do that best by participating in functions of the government, you know, all aspects.
I think we're raising more questions than we're answering with all these answers. I know I'm getting a lot more. Richard?
We seem to have a situation at times when the charter can be ignored by the council, especially by the mayor, and even by the solicitor who's supposed prime purpose is to enforce the law. What can the average citizen do? Would any petition to the court work? Is it almost like forming a riot and taking control? If the law can't be observed, then I don't think it's going to result in chaos, but I think we have a serious situation. And apparently, recently, the charter was ignored by all three actors. I don't think ever, something went to the court. I'm not familiar with all the detail, but I am concerned that no matter what you come up with, if it can be ignored, the future plan, by all three parties involved, what do the citizens do?
Come up with a charter that's designated so that there's no misinterpretation for the language. You have different churches that interpret the Bible several different ways. You have the Home Rule Charter that's language is interpreted by several different people. I think we need to develop a Home Rule Charter for dummies.
I agree.
I think that, you know, that's how I see a lot of things that go on, because everybody interprets it different. You know, they interpret the language, and, you know, I tell people, I'm a very simple person. I think simple. I speak simple. I speak that I want to be able to have a third grade level understand what I'm trying to say. So that's how I'd like to be talked to. Simple, very simple, and I'd like to understand things very simply. And I think over the course of time, they have complicated things because the public has lost a lot of interest in getting involved because they don't understand the language. They don't understand the language. And because of the dissension that occurs, because the council, the mayor, and the solicitor all have their own interpretation, it affects the public, who are the ones that make up the government, being there, because they're there to represent our best interest. And like I said, it's all a matter of having a simple plan play out, a simple plan that even a third grader can understand.
There's a recall section in the charter that if a public official is too far off the mark when they're doing their job, you can circulate a petition, get a certain number of signatures in that.
Yeah, but I understand that's a very cumbersome process, right. And I think somebody has to make the final decision, is the solicitor or the manager on that. So if you have, you want to have recall effective remedy, that might be, it's got to be a simpler and faster process. I don't know what the details of.
Essentially, I don't know if you want to have a recall thing be a regular occurrence.
Yeah, all right,
you know,
it's rare.
Essentially, there's going to be things public officials are going to do. I can think a number of things that the mayor or council have done that I'm not happy with, or, you know, I've expressed displeasure with over the years. And essentially, you know, but I'm not going to try and recall people because essentially they were the ones voted in for good or for ill. But the only thing I can think of is that maybe perhaps there's something that we could do in the charter revision, should this be approved by the voters, is perhaps, you know, if the elected officials violate the schedules in the charter, perhaps their salaries should be withheld until such time as they get back into alignment with the schedules in the charter.
Well, there's one thing that has to be understood about what a home rule charter is. A home rule charter has to have one aspect only. It has to have a governing body. And in our form of government, where we have our government, our form is a council, representative council. That's what we have. Presently, as it exists, we have four districts and three at large. That's the governing body. When the governing body is unable to govern, there's a problem. They are, under the present government, the most powerful body, and they can do pretty much what they want, except they have to act uniformly to be able to do that, especially when you have a 4-3 relationship or a 5-2 relationship. They are the governing body. They represent the public. The mayor doesn't represent the public. He only represents his own office. And the public has to understand that the difference with the, in the home rule form of government as compared to the other forms of government is that the power stems from the public, from the people, and only from the people. And the way it's structured is that they can do anything with the law under this charter revision. They can do anything they want to as long as it's not prohibited in the law. So there's lots of flexibility.
And go back to what Mary Ellen just said, that identifying the charter, simplifying the charter, gives those seven people on council a better understanding and that power that they need to make things work.
Michael, your comments about the recall, I found a little interesting, a little amusing, because actually I think probably there's worse situations can occur. I think in history we've read where kings didn't like the way their legislators did certain things, they had their heads cut off. Three worse things to happen.
But the president's impeachment was effectively the same thing. an attempted recall. And it was attempted not by the public, because after all, he ran out of elections. But it really occurred at that point by their council, which is the Congress and the Senate. So it's the same thing you have here. And if there is cause to remove an officer, you can do it. There is a means to do it. And then it's a matter of balance, and that's what the Charter Commission is all about.
I think one of the things that we brought this up is to have someone that is nonpartisan or not involved in the borough, other than the judges, because the county does not want to get involved in local politics, and they eventually find an excuse to send it back to either the zoning board or the hearing board. They don't want to get involved in the decisions. But a perfect example, I'll give you one example. One of the persons that ran for council and stated clearly in the Home Rule Charter that if they're going to be a candidate, that they must resign a position in any of the boards for the borough within 10 days previously to filing their petition. The deadline for filing the petition was 5 days away, and one of the people who filed the petition for a council might exceed was in attendance on the board that he was on, voted on that day, and answered here to a roll call. Now it's stated 10 days before. I don't know when the petition was filed, but the deadline was 5 days away. He couldn't file it after that deadline, so he had to have broken the Home Rule Charter. There was no one who would address that. The mayor chose not to address it. Council wouldn't do anything. Solicitor chose not to address it. And several attorneys shied away from taking the case. They did not want to get involved in local politics. What they said was local politics. I said, this is not local politics. It's a breaking of the law. What we have to put in place is if you have a complaint about someone that you feel has broken the Home Rule Charter, you should be able to file a written grievance to that person, and they should look at it and say, okay, he attended this meeting, his name is there, deadline was 5 days, they did not resign 10 days before that period, therefore their petition is thrown out. You can't get that. I've had other problems where I've gone to the district attorney, who is now a commissioner. I've gone to the state attorney general, said, well, you have to go back to your DA. I've gone back to the DA, wouldn't do anything. Went back to the attorney general. The investigator told me, he said, I'll file all these reports. He said, but I'll tell you now, nothing will happen. And he was right. And there were situations where there were definite felonies committed. And my point is, well, where do I go next? This is one of the things that has to be addressed, where someone can come up with a grievance, go somewhere where it will be addressed according to the Home Rule Charter and according to what is done. Say, yes, this has been violated, that should be done. So I felt that was definitely a problem.
Very good point, Joe. How do you keep your politicians accountable if higher-ups don't want to get involved? Very good point. Yoli, you have another question?
Yes, I do. I had, I don't remember if it was Mr. Daniel or Mr.
Chinchilla.
I don't know which one of you had brought up. I think it was Mr. Bonio. That also, you said no term limits if someone is doing a good job. You did. When I heard that, I'm a little concerned of having someone in a position, for an indefinite, period of time.
How you see something wrong with that?
Well, my concern is, some of our history, particularly with our politicians, both nationally and locally, that have been long term in position. Complacency sets in, taking it for granted that, well, I'm in this position, so it's going to be done this way. I do have some concerns when I hear that an individual is going to be in a position for an indefinite period of time.
Well, don't you feel that a council person or a mayor, or whatever the case may be, if is doing a good job, that he should get out after 2 years? I don't think our state representatives have term limits. Hoffel's been in for a third term.
He's been voted back in.
Pardon?
All right. I feel that's a little different because he gets voted back in. The people are going out there to vote based on what his performance has been in his previous term.
Well,
right?
You have to get voted back in also in this condition. You don't, just because you held a position doesn't say you get it. You have to be voted back in.
Oh, you didn't, I'm sorry, you didn't clarify that. I didn't
well, term that. Limits indicate, how long a candidate or a person can run for office. The President of the United States can only run for 2 terms. That's what you consider a term limit. Hoffel can run for as many terms as he wants to. Mm-hmm. Ed Hall, which was our senator from Pennsylvania, I forget how many years he was in.
35 years.
How many?
35
years. I'll have to go back to, again, referring to Mr. Santangelo, Paul Santangelo. He was in all those years.
Yeah, but see, in this local level, this small, what happens? They become a strong political figure. And they control a large number of votes. And they can get in, not because of all the good that they have done, but because they're in charge of a certain political faction that can produce enough votes at the polls to have them reelected. And this is why I definitely am in favor of term limits in this small community. And we presently have a mayor who is capable of this.
Well, if the people are satisfied, they're satisfied. But if the present mayor wants to run again, there's enough people out there. There's 32,000 people. I guess there's 12,000 voting people in Norristown. If they don't feel he's doing the job.
Yeah, but some of them reside elsewhere. Some of them reside up on 202. Yeah. They vote, and that's not right.
Well, that's what we're here for, to determine these things. Yeah. I didn't think Clinton should have ran the second election, but I don't know anybody to turn them down. So, he was on 2 terms. And I'll tell you the truth, he probably would have ran for 3 terms if there was no term limits with him, but that's just the way it is. I mean, if he's doing the job for the people of this town, fine. And the people should have the right to say it. If they're not unhappy with him, then they vote them back in, or they don't go to the polls. Usually that's what happens. But if they're unhappy with them, get them out to vote.
But you have more faith in the voters than I do.
Well.
Unfortunately, there may be, I don't know where you got your figures, 12,000 voters. Unfortunately, when you're at the polls.
Registered voters. There's 12.
Well, sad thing, even the registered voters, it's very sad that not even the registered voters show up.
I agree with you 100%.
Actually, part of the problem is this charter was written before the Motor Voter Act. And so some, there are some stipulations in the state law that don't take the motor voter act in the situation into case. So for example, we have a lot of people who are registered voters now who, because the motor voter act says that they should remain for through two presidential elections, means that they can be on the books for a period of 9 years or 8 years, something of that nature. But in reality, they moved away 5 years ago, or 6 years ago. And it's still, that's a consideration in terms of the total number of voters we have. So we really have probably, at best, 9,000 voters, and 3,000 are simply false names, or 4,000 are false names.
And if they know that, someone can come and vote in their place.
Yeah.
And that's the problem.
And part of the reason for the term limits as before, and I might want to reconsider that this time, the commission might want to consider doing something else about it, but it was because of false names. Because he didn't have, in fact, have so much power that not only was he president of council, but he was also president of roads for Norristown. He was also the president of public safety, which meant he picked the policeman, and was the chairman of the Civil Service Commission, which meant not only did he pick the policeman, but he promoted the policeman. So there can be too much power associated with being a councilman for 62 years.
Keith, do you actually have a question?
No, but I'm, this is interesting.
Okay. Well, actually, I have a couple. As I said, you've raised more questions now, and if you don't mind, as a moderator, if I can ask a couple questions. And I guess this goes back to one of the issues about something that Rochelle had brought up about an inability to talk to the committee heads. And then it goes into, I guess, what Joe and Al were saying, possibly about, well, they are under the direct jurisdiction of the mayor, therefore they have to, they're both hired and fired, so I guess there's that control issue there. I guess my question is, under the rights that the council has to subpoena department heads or anyone actually within the borough to gather information, wouldn't that basically imply that they have the right then to question? Or does this imply that the only way they can question the department head would be by subpoena? Anybody care to answer, feel that question?
Well, I can tell you that the council has the right to issue a subpoena, which means that five members or the majority of council have a right to issue a subpoena. That's distinctly different than if a person wants to contact someone. But Joe's completely right. This absolutely makes no sense whatsoever for the council not to be able to talk with the director. Makes no sense. I mean, the council person has less rights than an ordinary citizen has. And the council person has to have access to information. And if they have to go through a third party all the time, through the director, which means that they funnel more information through him, and he can't possibly know as much as about individual departments as the individual directors do. It doesn't make any sense at all. There should be complete cooperation with the mayor to be allowed to turn all the directors over to the council people. Not dominate them or order them. That's a different issue, which is what Joe brought up.
Just ask a question about areas in our own district.
Any questions that you should be able to contact them anytime and say, what about this and what about that, and when are you going to do this and why is this?
Yes, Phil, this, to take that question further, you might be the best person to answer. Is there actually a provision in the charter that allows the council to talk to department heads?
No. The charter is a loosely written section, which leaves a lot unsaid. It's like the Bible or anything else that you write. Just things that are obviously common sense aren't written into the charter, and it shouldn't make any effort to do that. But it says what they shall do and what prohibitions there will be. But something that just anybody who thinks about it at all realizes that the council has to have access to the employees, the other employees, at least in some sense. And whenever they want it, how else can they operate their government? If they have the right to raise the money for that department and pay that guy, why can't they talk to that guy?
I guess my question is, do they, is there a provision actually in the charter that specifically precludes them from, because I would understand
absolutely
that if it's not precluded, it would
absolutely
be allowed.
Absolutely not. See, Joe had her right, and so did Michelle.
Mark?
For the commission, for the candidates, due to the fact that the loose writing, the intent of the charter has been abused by the government, would you consider writing clauses that are that cannot be misinterpreted into the new charter if you are elected?
That's where the charter for dummies comes in.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd like to hear Joe's answer as well.
Well, I personally think that it almost doesn't matter how many words you put in there. People aren't willing to follow the law, and there is no mechanism for forcing them to do so. You know, people are going to violate the law and have to feel like, which could seem to have occurred on paper. So I'm not sure what words you could put in there that will force compliance with the charter. Essentially, people have to elect people who are willing to comply with the law, and the voters have to be willing to hold their feet to the fire. So, in my opinion, we should make an effort to address that to the greatest degree can be addressed, but ultimately, I don't think there's any way you could have the charter force the public officials to behave the way they should.
It's been my experience over the years that the omission or addition of one, two, or maybe even three small words would make the intent so much more clear. Everyone understands the intent, but it has been, the interpretations have been abused.
If I can, another question for the panel. If I understand it correctly, and I know there's been a lot of comment here today about conflict if there are different parties between the mayor and or council. By my understanding of the responsibilities of both parties, the conflict, I guess I can't see where it comes from. If the council is primarily, their job is to create the law, and if it's the mayor's job to implement the law, where would the conflict, I guess, where would the conflict come then, other than, well, toss that out for whoever?
For control. It's very simple. That the under the way the whole charter is written now, if the mayor wants to do something, he can resist because he has control over the solicitor and the business administrator. So he, they're lined up where they're not going to say anything. And the solicitor, who should be council's guide to what's right and what's wrong, has now been eliminated. The business manager, who has the duty and obligation to keep them fully informed, he's been eliminated by this control as well. So that you, that's the barrier you're up against, where the mayor is forcing administration to be against council, not cooperative.
Be more specific then. You take one specific example, and simply could be council is going to file a resolution saying we want Elm Street paved from here to there, and pass it, and then supposedly the funds are, let's consider the funds are in the budget.
They can pass, well, see that, the budget.
Let's not go there, Joe.
That was a very bad word to use.
Okay, well,
what has happened, the money has been, see, the administration has control of where the money is going to be. Another example on that, without getting too deeply involved, it says pretty well in the Home Rule Charter that if any expenditure is going to exceed $10,000, then it has to be put out for bids. They built a salt storage shed behind Borough Hall. It never went out for bids. If there's anybody in this room that can build a storage shed like that for less than $10,000, send them up to my house because I want one built for my property. That's
it.
that's a perfect example.
I'm not sure if you're getting my point. If a very specifically detailed outline, say we want Elm Street from such and such block to such and such block paved in this month of time frame, very specifically, and give a specification to it, whatever.
If the money was in allotted for that, then they could do that.
Well, I guess that's my point is, can't council then, if they specifically pass a resolution, ordinance, or whatever, saying this is what we want, doesn't the legislative end or the executive end have to pursue what they've been directed to do?
I don't know legally.
If the council passes an ordinance and says this is what we want done,
that should be done.
Then it should be done. And there has to be some give and take in case something goes wrong. But the notion that the mayor of the administration can do whatever it wants and disregard council means that they're ignoring the governing body.
There should be something within that charter that specifies what happens if the administration ignores the governing body.
Well, you already have something in the charter. It says that if the administration, if the mayor ignores the covenants of the charter and the will of the public in any respect, and specific prohibitions within the charter, that it can be removed. He or she.
Mark?
As you know, the impeachment process is complicated, to say the least. It can be done. There's an appeal provision where the impeached party goes to the court of common pleas for the appeal. Is there anything that you can think of that would make sense to include or exclude in those provisions in that language with regard to impeachment? And is it something that you will look into if you are elected?
Well, we did look into that when we wrote the charter last time, and that's pretty well governed by general law. In other words, there has to be. Elected body is difficult to remove from office, any elected person. And this is why the Attorney General doesn't want to get involved with it, why they're particularly cautious about arresting Scott, even though there's criminal matters involved. But the point is, an elected official has, it always has to appear like whatever is done on a criminal basis, that's like in that case, a criminal matter, is not a political act. And particularly in the case when it is in fact a political act, any violation of civil law, which is the act of the charter, it becomes a political act, right? So what you have to do is, the general law has to protect that person who's elected to some extent, and they do that through an appeal process, and that's what you have. Can it be refined? It might be, and the solicitor for the Government Study Commission, if elected, will have an opportunity to voice their opinion. And ultimately, you know, you don't have any answers until you do go to court, until there is an appeal. Isn't that what happens? I mean, you really don't know what the answers are. So it's tested in court, maybe tested in the Commonwealth Court, tested again in the Supreme Court. So there are lots of areas that you get into that you don't know about. And you just have to have courage to be willing to lose in court. Like when you go into battle, you have to be prepared you might lose. You have to expect to win.
Yes, if I, one more question. Bill, I think I'd probably direct this to you because you're the one that has mentioned the solicitor issue more than once. My understanding of the charter is the solicitor is hired by the mayor, approved by the council. And I guess maybe where I lose it is, who is the solicitor serving? Is it the council does he serve? Is he serve the mayor? Is he supposed to serve both? Or
The solicitor is the solicitor for the entire borough. He serves the mayor, and he serves primarily the government, which is the governing body. In other words, he does not represent the mayor except when that mayor has a problem. And he can't represent the mayor during an impeachment process. Ultimately, he always has to represent the governing body first because that is the government. The other person is one function of government, but the governing body is the most powerful house. He can't represent he can't represent the mayor to the exclusion of council, but he has to represent the borough. And you can't have two people who, say, two separate solicitors for the borough, because you might have two different voices acting for, on their behalf in courts. All of that.
So what you're saying is he's hired by the mayor, but he's supposed to serve primarily the council?
Hired by the mayor with the approval of council. And his term, according to the new Home Rule Charter, ends whenever the mayor's term ends or whenever he's removed from office. And ultimately, there's also the power of the pulpit, which council has to keep in mind, because that's more powerful than many laws.
Marge?
Would you consider clarifying that language in the new Home Rule Charter if the commission is established?
I would say that it should be hired by the mayor and council with the approval of both.
At the completion or the beginning of each term, not indefinitely. The language of the charter right now says indefinitely. And again, going back to my comment about the inclusion or exclusion of one or two words can make all the difference in the world.
Well, and then I would also include they could be fired by five, at least the majority of five council members, and or the mayor of approval of both. So the idea is you want somebody in there that's doing a good job, and he knows he has to be responsible to both groups. I think you'll find a much different person than you have where someone's in there who is at the mercy of the mayor.
So indefinitely for a term, and including two words or three words for that term would make all the difference in the world.
In other words,
to clarify,
you're saying that
the entire
every
charter.
Every 2 or 4 years, yes. Or what, yes. Solicitor should be hired?
Yes. Just the word indefinitely is ambiguous.
That's already in the new law. They changed that already.
Meaning, to clarify the comment,
that the solicitor's term ends at the time the mayor's term ends.
Is that different than the past?
It wasn't spelled out like
it is now. Specified before then.
So basically, you're implying it's ambiguous.
Well, it shouldn't have been, but it could be.
Again,
and there is also a problem. Now, let's assume, and I don't, I hate that. Let's assume you have a situation where the January comes and council now is in an impasse as to who they want to approve. You still have to have somebody representing the borough.
Correct.
So who shall that be? And the way it reads now, it says indefinite because it goes up to that, in other words, until such time is replaced. And that's the way specifically most offices are treated, right?
Now, what about this? The solicitor is the mayor's private attorney.
That's an ethical problem, right?
Well, that should be addressed.
Conflict of interest. We're going to have, when we have this commission, and when the commission is formed, I was talking to a gentleman up in Harrisburg that's what his job is, working municipalities. And he would come down and spend time with us, you know, for questions that you have like that, and how could it be incorporated, or is it in there some way that we're not seeing it? But he said he would come down, that's his job up there, to work on Home Rule Charters, and he would come down and sit with us. Now, when the commission is formed, is it going to be open to the public that we can thrash this out, or are we going to thrash it out and have the public come? I don't know how that's going to be formed. That's be set up by the commission. But this fellow from Harrisburg, Joe Epifano gave me his name, I called him, and he said that's his job. He would come down and answer some of these questions.
Is he a, if I can, is he an authority that can be gone
that's
to?
That's his job. His
for
job
question
is
and answers for interpretation of the Home Rule Charter?
Right, that's all he does.
Formation and interpretation.
Is that a legal interpretation, such as the court would issue, or is this just a recommendation?
They're recommendations according to his knowledge of the Home Rule Charter. I think Mary Ellen's...
Sounds fairly persuasive.
I think Mary Ellen's giving you the long sign.
Okay, well, I think we're about to be closing. If a quick summary then, I'll highlight a few notes that I've made of key points that looks like we're going to be maybe discussing if this referendum passes, and that's going to be committee heads is an issue, who hires, who fires, and who they're responding to. Solicitor, who hires, who fires, and who he serves. Consideration of other different forms of government. I think I've heard reference other than the Home Rule Charter. the ability to, of council to address directors of the different departments within the borough. How do you hold the feet of the administration to the fire for interpretation, or I just said, I guess the implementation of the laws? Apparently there seems to be a lot of general misunderstanding about what the Home Rule Charter stands for and what it is, and hopefully this is just the beginning of the process of getting the committee to understand this, so when they go to vote for it in not too distant future, they have enough understanding to say, well, yes, this is something we do need, and yes, these are the individuals that we do want to form the study to make those necessary changes. If I had to summarize one big single generalization, it is that you all seem to believe that there is a necessary change we should be seeing, and I guess that's why you're all here, because you believe strongly enough that you would like to be a party to that change. And us in the community, thank you for your willingness to serve. We do understand that as a non-paying position, and they're always the ones that are most beaten up by the public and at least appreciate it. But we thank you all for willing to do that. So again, we thank everyone for coming today, and we hope to see you again in April when we meet our new representatives. Thank you.
We'll see you then.
April 4th.